Okay, here I am today with the number one leadership thinker in the world. We have the number one executive coach in the world and three times best-selling author on the New York Times list, Marshall Goldsmith, here to share.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay. This is Arthur Carmazzi, best-selling author and currently ranked as one of the world's top 10 thought leaders in organizational culture and leadership. And I'm right here at his room in Bali at the Ritz-Carlton. And this is such an exciting moment to actually have the Marshall Goldsmith here with me. So your job basically is to help leaders to essentially become the best that they can, okay? And you've got various processes and systems to do that. So how would you relate that to basically leading a better organizational culture?
Well, to me, my job is helping successful leaders achieve positive and long-term change in their behavior.
Their behavior, okay.
And to me, the organizational culture is behavior, and the leader is the key because the leader needs to be the role model for the values of the organization. So rather than just saying we need to do X, people look at that leader behavior, and if the behavior doesn't match the values, then the real message about the culture is not what they say it is.
Right.
Culture is the way they act.
Okay.
So okay. People really believe that what's important to you is not what you say, it's what you do.
Fair enough.
So our behavior speaks louder than our words. And what happens is if there's an incongruity between the words and the behavior, then the culture is very mixed. And in many cases, people would assume the real culture is the behavior, not the words.
Okay. So now, is the leader himself going to determine the entire culture? Or are there other factors that are also...
Oh, there are many other factors. And again, each person in a large organization, there are many levels of leadership. On the other hand, the higher up you go, the more impact they have.
Okay.
So if you're the CEO of the company and the company's preaching X and everybody sees you, the CEO, doing Y, that sends a very, very dysfunctional message to the organization.
All right. So let's say, for example, that you are the leader of a larger organization, okay, and you are preaching Y and you're doing Y, but things aren't working out. What could be the possible reasons for that?
Well, again, there could be breakdown on any level in the organization. For example, one thing you and I've talked about is the compensation system.
Okay.
There's a great article called The Folly of Hoping for A and Paying for B. It's about companies that hope people do one thing and pay them to do something else. Well, you know, we tend to do what we get paid to do, not what people hope we're going to do. So you need to align the compensation system, you need to align the reward system, and you need to align the executive behavior all in the same direction, if possible.
Okay, all right, okay. And so how would, let's say, for example, you've got a middle manager.
Yes.
All right, and maybe their boss is not really aligned with what the culture they're trying to do. Okay, they've been tasked with doing, developing the culture, and their boss is not necessarily aligned with it, but their boss is the one that's given them the task.
Right.
Okay, what do they do?
Well, okay, Peter Senge had a good point about this. You can achieve meaningful organizational change at any level if the person at the top of that level supports a change and if it is not sabotaged from above. If it's sabotaged from above, it's not going to work.
Of course.
And so the one thing I do teach is how do you deal with people when you don't have line authority? So Peter Drucker taught me this. He said that our mission in life is to make a positive difference, not to prove we're smart, not to prove we're right, number one. Number two, every decision is made by the person who has the power to make the decision. So if you have the power to make the decision, then one word to describe the decision maker is customer. One word to describe the person is salesperson. They don't have to buy.
Okay.
You have to sell. And in life, sell what you can sell and change what you can change. And if you can't sell it, you know what? You can't sell it. And what do you do about it? Leave or work around it. Do your best.
Okay. All right. Okay. Excellent. So now, as let's say, for example, you've got an organizational culture that is a little bit dysfunctional. Now, the leader has just walked into the new company and they're really trying to make a difference. But people are maybe, you know, blaming each other. It's not, you know, it's not a fun place to work. Their compensation package is really good, but that's pretty much the only reason people stay. There's no engagement. Okay. What would you do? What advice would you give for that?
Well, the first thing is it takes a while. Mm-hmm. So nobody believes when any new leader comes in there. Why would they believe this new leader is different than the previous new leader and the previous new leader before that? Mm-hmm. So, you know, this kind of credibility is not built in a day.
Okay.
So it doesn't matter what the leader says. Nobody necessarily believes they're telling the truth anyway. This occurs only over time. I can give you something people can do immediately, though.
Oh, yeah. What would that be?
Yeah, and that's, I've done some interesting research where get everyone in the organization to ask questions that are called active questions.
Active questions.
Historically, you mentioned employee engagement. It's all passive questions. Mm-hmm. Do you have clear goals? Do you have meaningful work? Do you have a best friend at work? And my daughter, Kelly, is a professor at Vanderbilt. She's done research on this. Mm-hmm. If people are asked passive questions, they have a negative response. They blame the environment. So do you have clear goals? No, why not? Well, they're confused. Do you have meaningful work? No, they make me do trivia. Do you have a best friend at work? No, they're jerks.
Okay.
It's their fault. Well, active questions begin with the phrase, did I do my best to?
Okay.
Number one, did I do my best to set clear goals? Number two, did I do my best to make progress toward achieving my own goals? Number three, did I do my best to be happy? Number four, did I do my best to find meaning? Number five, did I do my best to build positive relationships?
Brilliant.
And number six, did I do my best to be fully engaged? And our research on this is, you know, you can't argue with 95 studies, almost 5,000 people in our research. And if you just ask yourself these 10 questions every day, it's amazing the positive difference because it's the antithesis of blaming. See, the one question you can't blame anybody else for is one that starts with, did I do my best?
Uh-huh. Exactly.
You can't pass that buck on to anyone.
Exactly. That's brilliant.
Yeah,
that's fantastic. Actually, we in DC psychology, we have one thing called active trust. Mm-hmm. You know, in some cases, you know, organizations, I mean, really need to try to show trust mm-hmm. to other people. Managers mm-hmm. need to show trust. Leaders need to show trust. But sometimes they just don't. Mm-hmm. Okay. So one of the things we advocate is active trust. So by at least actively trusting them, even though you may not feel it, mm-hmm. okay, by letting people to maybe fail and what we call fail intelligently,
right.
then they will be able to develop the skill and you'll develop the actual trust that goes with that skill.
Good.
Okay. So one last thing, okay? What would you say to the people watching? What would be that one bit of advice that you would give everybody watching the show?
Take a deep breath. Imagine you're 95 years old and you're just getting ready to die. What advice would that wise 95-year-old you who knows what mattered in life, what didn't, and what counts and what doesn't, what advice would that old person have for the you that's listening to me right now? Just breathe. Think about that. Whatever you're thinking now, do that. In terms of performance appraisal, that's the only one that matters. That old person says you did the right thing, you did. That old person says you made a mistake, you did. You don't have to impress anybody else. Some friends of mine interviewed old people and three basic themes come up. Theme number one is be happy now. Not next week, not next month, not next year. The great Western disease, I will be happy when. When I get the status money, BMW, condominium, I will be happy when. A common comment from old people, I got so busy chasing what I did not have, I could not see what I did have when I had everything. So, you know, many people I work with, I tell them you're among the luckiest people ever lived. So number one, be happy now. Number two, friends and family and people. When you're 95 years old, you realize your friends and family are important. And you realize all those people you tried to help, that's important. And I've asked a lot of CEOs what mattered, what was mm-hmm. important to you. And all they talk about is people they help.
Okay.
None of them talk about how big their office was. And then the final advice is the same, just go for it. You know, go for it. Old people, we almost never regret the risks we take and fail. We all regret the risk we failed to take. So just, you know, you may not win, but at least try.
All right. All right. Well, thank you, Marshall. It has been an absolute pleasure
to
have you here.
Thanks for watching the Knights of Transformation. If you'd like to see more videos like this one, subscribe to Carmazzi TV on YouTube.